Good evening, good morning, namaste to everybody. You know, we have a very esteemed panel with us, and I'll talk about them in a second. But this is a very, very interesting topic. I think sessions like these are also opportunities that actually helps in identifying what could be the potential post-pandemic bloom that we should be looking into, right? With that said, today, if you look at successful executives, all of them almost have an ability to experience the world through the eyes and emotions of customers, asking, what do I hate about a particular product or a process, whichever they are solving today? They also catalog every frustration, complication, and source of uncertainty that they face through the process. And then they work ruthlessly to eliminate or minimize each point on the hassle map. And that's the end result that people love and competitors can't copy. If that is what is an ambition for every single person on this call today, I think this is almost like an Indian movie, right? We all know the end story, hero always wins. We know there will be few comedy, few songs and bashing of the villain, everything is going to be there. Despite knowing the outcome, I think it is the method to that madness. It's our ability to actually understand how to make that achieve is what we are trying to do. A simple example of what we will be learning today is that moment when Reed Hastings actually had frustration in returning his cassettes to the library. That resulted in a large setup, and I'm sure a moment like this, which is keeping us company, which is Netflix, has actually come out. And I think every people whom we look at, successful entrepreneurs, like a Steve Jobs or a Jeff Bezos or a Michael Bloomberg, each one of them have probably had that ability to experience the world through the eyes and emotions of the customer. With that said, I'll introduce the panel to you. We have a bunch of experienced people who have tried to solve this at various points in time and various walks and various perspectives. It's a very mix and match of the panel that's likely to provide a different vantage point, view per se. Here we have Srinivas Kotamasu, we call him KSR, who's going to bring in a services perspective, a large veteran in the IT industry, handle a lot of services and product support space. So it'll be good to hear some perspective on the services side of the business. We have Murli. Murli again is a very senior person, consciously chose this path to be on the technology side of the house, keeps us all on tab with respect to what sort of tech to follow, what are the trends, what do you wait and watch, and so on and so forth. We'll try to hear from him on those perspectives today. Suhas, incidentally, I don't want to use the word my partner in crime, but essentially my partner in solving many of these hassles that we are likely to face in our day-to-day business lives. And Suhas will talk to us about from a digital transformation and a lot of confusion around, is that what is actual hassle map, and so on and so forth. Swami, again, a long-term friend, a lot of discussions from a comfort of an enterprise, moving into a startup and living through the hassles of a startup and successfully managed to live through it multiple times and wanting to go back to that same thing again and again is something that I love what Swami does. And another veteran in the industry who has been the main breadwinner or the rainmaker for us in our businesses. He handles the business side of the house, and I've seen him more from how he has made in companies to rake in money, right? So today's session is going to be about hassle maps and value creation. Without much ado, let's start with you, KSR. Basic question, what is hassle map? I mean, all of us know hassles, but what are these hassle maps that we are talking about? Is this something fundamentally?
So thanks for that, Kaushik. As you mentioned during the preamble, hassle map is not something that is new. It has been around for more than 15, 20 years almost. It's a tool that you can use to map the experiences that your customer goes through while consuming your products or services, and with the specific focus on what is it making it difficult for your customers to consume your service. So basically, it focuses on the negative experiences. The negative experiences could be, the time it takes to consume the service or perform an activity to, or the amount of money that they need to spend in order to get the service, which could be lower, or the kind of interaction that they're having with your service providers within the staff, the kind of interaction that they're having and the kind of emotions that they're creating within that interaction. So it could be any of these matters, which is actually overall leaving your customers with a bad experience, because of which either they are shying away from your service or reluctantly using your service, which if you are able to remove these hassles, you would be able to generate a lot more demand for your products and services, and customers will end up with a positive experience in consuming your service. So that is basically the premise of HassleMap. And it just provides you a tool, a way of thinking about your business process or the product that you are providing or the service that you are providing to your customers. While the HassleMap basically, when you are designing a product or service, you typically tend to focus more on the positive aspects, the design aspects. Like, this is the kind of positive experiences that my customer should have. But while creating that, unknowingly, you are leaving some of the blind spots in the process, which may end up creating negative experiences for the customers. If you do not pay any attention to them, all the positive aspects that you have built into your service may actually can get negated. So that is the thing that you are focusing on, HassleMap. Basically, by focusing on the negatives, you are creating enormous amount of positive impact for your product or service. That's what HassleMap is about. And this technique could be utilized to improve the customer satisfaction. It could be used to increase the demand for your products and customer service. These are the areas where you can actually apply this technique. But this is when you are doing it in a reactive sense. You already have some business that you are already providing the services or products. But if you are creating the new service or a new product, if you are able to incorporate the HassleMap thinking into designing the customer experience from the beginning, then you might have a chance to create a revolutionary product or service. So that's the experience that industry has seen. And this concept was introduced and popularized by Professor Adrian Slavorsky. And he's a world-renowned consultant in this area, HassleMap thinking and value migration and value creation. That's where this concept comes from.
Fabulous. I thought I got a clarity, but no, it kind of says, this is also this. Anyway, I'll come back to you soon with that. That brings another interesting perspective. Does it necessarily have to be same for every industry? Or what does that mean from a business perspective? Could you throw some examples and some citing on that?
Yeah. So just to take from what Kiyasa said, I think it's the journey or it's the steps or these hassles that a customer faces. Could be a product, it could be a service. So it's applicable across all industry channels. So it's not that it's only for product. Obviously, in a product, you can improve the offerings of the product and make it better. But services are very intangible, right? So you absolutely have no idea what are the challenges or the hassles a customer face. For example, I can just, it's a very, very service-oriented organization in the area, the place that I live. It's more from an airline perspective, and how they transform the experience for their, premium members, because they found that, the premium members or their loyalty customers, they were being bracketed against the normal passengers. So they first probably created something where the experience changes. So they probably went to the customer, what is the hassle that you face? So right from the time they check in to the time, getting a priority check-in, priority counter for them. So they started off with that experience. And as they grew, they realized, what are the other hassles that the passenger faces or a loyalty member faces as he grows through the entire experience in the airline journey, right? Right from check-in to standing at the immigration counter, having come into the airport, how do he spend his time there? So what kind of a better experience can I give? Once you are boarded into the flight, what are the special things I can give you as a loyalty member? So those are the things that they created, and they improved because the hassle is that if you create one today, as the customer experiences that and he likes it, he needs something more. So this HassleMap journey is a continuous process, and you have to continuously evolve and see, as I give more services, expectation increases, and you have to continuously evolve around that process. So they created a lot of great things, right from earlier it was a separate check-in counter. Then they said, hey, why only a check-in counter? Customer wants an entire enclosure which is separate with an entire immigration which is separate. They don't need to go through the hassle. Then they created a brilliant business lounge where all these people could be there. Once they got into the flight, they were given, you know, priority access to watch movies, book their seats, choose their food. So they continuously evolved, and that's how, you know, experiences happen.
So that also tells essentially, you know, you're talking about a journey as an example. So then the question to you, Suhas, is customer journey mapping essentially an asset map mapping? Is that a step to digital transformation?
Interesting question, Kaushik. The way I see it, and I'll answer your question in 1 minute if you do not mind, I'm going to refute a little bit of what Shiv said. Aviation is something which is very close to my heart. So I'll use three different airlines as examples: Emirates, British Airways, and Jet Airways. Because I'm like all of us, I used to fly like crazy at a point of time. So Jet Airways, almost always, whenever I used to take the late night flight out of Bangalore to Mumbai those days, they would call me, ensure that I could reach at the last possible minute. Somebody would be there outside the airport. Somebody would whisk me through. My bag would disappear and would get to my seat automatically. I would be whisked through the entire airport, the entire process, and I would be in the plane in the next 5 minutes. British Airways used to actually provide this as well. Very early morning that I would fly, they would call and do the same thing. Emirates would send a Mercedes. Lovely, great. Ego boosted also. Now the problem with this was, getting that car actually helped nothing. I would go through the same whatever other process. I would really love if I could reduce the amount of time between the gate and the airplane gate so that I could arrive very late and go straight into the plane. Just because of the amount of flying that I used to do, it used to bother me to spend time at the airport. I don't need a lounge. I just want to get to the plane straight and do whatever I have to do, right? On the other side, while there was exclusivity in terms of travel and blah and all that, while you get off at Dubai and then you're swapping over, that change would be very painful. The flights from India, at least from Bangalore, the plane would be parked way out somewhere. Once in a while, they actually would send a car to go over, but there was like a 20-25 minute commute to the terminal. Completely killed it. My point is, and I'm now coming back to your question, when you're looking at a particular customer journey, what is it that you're trying to solve? Are you trying to just provide an amount of exclusivity to a customer, which is lovely, but is it solving the problem? Or am I just going and putting lipstick on the pig? To me, that is what Emirates was doing. While British Airways or Jet Airways would just squeeze that entire process for me. That helped. They also had an exclusive lounge and all that. And for most of the time, I never saw that lounge. And that is great. So long story short, it really is this. When I'm looking at a customer journey, am I looking at just those hassle points at those particular problems, or am I looking at that entire chain? Am I looking at that entire customer experience, customer journey to be able to now fix it? If I were to start thinking about it from a digital transformation point of view, two ways of looking at it. I could start looking at it and say, let me make my organization more effective, my processes more effective, more efficient to be able to serve the customer, which would be what British Airways or Jet Airways were wanting to do. Or a second different type is, let me just reimagine. There's an outcome on the side that I'm wanting to achieve. It might be completely different from doing all this business. Yeah, so it could be a completely different example. In a hypothetical world, your entire check-in process is pre-done. Your immigration somehow is pre-done. They pick you up from home and put you straight into the plane. Yeah, if there were such a legal mechanism of doing that, then that would be reimagining. Same problem, same set of hassles being removed, but it completely sort of reimagines the entire process. So I think that's what it is about. What are you using that hassle map for? Are you taking this one particular interaction point and trying to smoothen it? Or are you wanting to impact the entire customer journey? That's the way I see it for DX.
I think two probably disclaimers, if you will. One is, speakers naming names are only on their personal view. Chatinar, Network Gain, and Terrain does not have any stance on that. No points. Well,
I have no connection with any of these three airlines.
Perfect.
Never been a client.
And I thought you literally took the customer journey as your own journey. Good customer, though. Perfect. Swami, that brings in another perspective, right? I mean, as a startup, you know, having been there, done that multiple times, you have your own hassle of survival in the first place, right? So are you also applying a similar, or would all startups apply a similar lens, or how?
I mean, very, very interesting standpoint if you look at it, right? You know, like KSR was highlighting, this as a concept has been existing in various different forms, shapes, sizes, long since, right? And startups have been the primary consumer of this because we had been blessed with the luxury of starting completely with a different eye rather than going with the conventions, trying to challenge it. And that also started giving the entrepreneurs a kick in butt. You know, say, why should I take you as a company to invest or to buy your services or products in whatever way, right? So that always has been the case. And hence, every entrepreneur first starts with mapping the customer's pain, tries to look at what exactly is happening with the current way of, you know, the things which are moving. Take an example of Kirana stores. At some point in time, if a Kirana has to buy a product and put it in their shelf and, you know, sell it to the customer, they have to go through either to a wholesale market, buy, come back and put it there, which also means closing the shop for some time and you know, not able to servicing the customer. You know, they need to know exactly where to go, where to buy and what to do. And then the other option is the distributors, sales agents coming and knocking their doors. And all of them used to come with many different products. And the hassle of product discovery, price discovery, and the hassles of making sure that the supply chain, the right time, right product, right stock coming into their shelves was a big nightmare, right? The success depended on whoever handled it well within the limitations. Now, thanks to technology, the models which have really brought in today, right? You take a Udaan or a JioMart or many of these, you know, ShopX and all of these guys have come up with models which today completely relook at how a Kirana does a product discovery, price discovery, and ensures the product availability in a shelf. So this, if you look at it, it came from a perspective of Kirana as a customer and his hassles, and then you're remapping it and then creating a business model around it. Then you start building efficiency more and more. Now, there are companies like, you know, the one which I'm trying to start now is going one step above and say, can I even go better and say Kirana is the guy and everything else revolve around his ecosystem. So these is a constant thing which we always challenge, and, you know, one after the other startups keep coming and redoing or reimagining the way things are done. Another example could be your banking, BFSI, you know, banking fintech startups. 5-10 years back, if you recollect a payment or FD, you know, which you wanted to open in your account, or even a very, very simple thing like opening an account itself. The hassles of a customer going to a bank with like 10 forms to be filled, and few of them, you know, we'll just sign without even knowing what the heck we are signing, and having to have like 4 or 5 different documents. They will send you back saying this document is not there, that document is not there. The whole journey was so painful. The fintech as an industry has completely evolved by challenging those hazards and shifting the value from what we call it as a traditional banking ways to the new era or neo banking mechanisms. And the underbanked and unbanked are now already, you know, coming on board into this, right? It's a very, very clear both expansion and value creation just because you have addressed a set of hassles which a customer was going through. Clearly, startups have been one of the pioneers, largely because of the way they are set up, right? They're lean, you know, they can re-look at things in a very different lens and challenge it as and when applicable. I don't see any difference between enterprises and this, but we have more advantage if I were to put it that way.
Makes absolute sense. And by the way, those forms, I think the hassle itself was reading it. Signing was
very true. Very true.
Digitally, it has just become, I agree, acceptable use policy.
Kaushik, may I add something? So, going on from what Swami said, I like that. And see, the way hassle maps get used, or even you can sort of surpass just the usual ability, is our fintech space today is very different because of essentially three things, what we DX guys call JAM, Jandhan, Aadhaar and mobile, right? So before these three together came in, there are a whole bunch of things which you just couldn't do. New things opened up, and this is even a situation where it's not as if a hassle was creating some particular type of problems, but in a situation where you just could not do a few certain things, and you provide, I mean, using hassle map to a completely different extent, you suddenly can do a whole bunch of things, right? It's to add to what Swami was mentioning.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, one thing I wanted to add, and one question I wanted to ask actually. See, similar to what Suhas said, you know, I'm currently working with a company in the health insurance area. So they are trying to create a digital healthcare platform, not just focusing on the insurance. They're also bringing in the care providers, that is the hospitals, clinics, and the healthcare centers into that fold, and also the consumers, basically the people, the patients who are consuming the services, both from the insurance companies as well as care providers. Apart from that, they're also trying to bring on board the medical research organizations. So by creating this platform where the fundamental data is useful in many contexts across the life cycle of a patient, they're able to improve the healthcare delivery systems and also try to bring down the cost of service delivery itself. The boundaries of the hassle map mapping, so that is expanding. The moment you say, okay, I'm doing the hassle mapping in my area of service. But if your service interacts with multiple adjacent services, and if you're able to expand the hassle mapping domain to encompass all these services, the power of the map that you can create and the power of solving those problems is enormous. You know, it's just exponentially beneficial for organizations to create. Even though they are focused on their own niche, by providing the solutions to solving the problems in the surrounding areas, they can actually increase the value that they are creating for their customers. So that's just I wanted to add to what Suha said. But one question I wanted to ask for Swami is hassle mapping a good way of thinking when you are actually considering a pivot in the context of a startup?
We always do. In a way, when hassle maps are your direct reflection of how your existing product or a service is either, you know, took off or did never take it off. So you would have actually mapped, I mean, all of us go through that as a process first, look at who is my customer, who will buy, what will they buy and all that, and then create a product with all, you know, blood and sweat into it, all passion into it. But then when we start realizing that it is not taking off the way we thought, we clearly see that, you know, something we missed. That miss is nothing but a hassle which got created into the ecosystem by us inadvertently, right? And once we realize that is what it is happening, and that's why, you know, every startup founder will talk about, I went to the field, I was in the trucking industry. So we say like, okay, we have been with the truckers throughout their journey, not just one day, 2 days, but multiple times, multiple days, right? There, we clearly see how our solutions are getting adopted and where do I actually, instead of helping him or her, created more issues. And that is a very starking reflection on what we introduced ourselves as a part of the process. That also leads us to the question of saying, are we doing it the right way? Should we pivot into a completely different model? Or should we just tweak and continue attempting doing more, right? So it actually serves a lot of purpose in terms of reassessing our own, how we take things forward.
And I'm going to, at this point in time, reassess this conversation to Murali, give him an introduction bit, and then get back into the conversation. So really a lot of things going on, and then I think it just opens up the kimono per se. Question to you, where are we on the tech and technology solutions or trends in this space? And some highlights on that numbers, please.
I will start with the two important trends that are happening. And then I'll go a little bit into the connect between technologies and the hazard maps, if you will. The first one is talking about time is reporting, that every company thinks it's a technology company. You know, that is the landscape it's going through. Another trend that's talking about software is eating everything. You know, that is again another popular notion that we are grappling with. So these two, if you look at it, so many technologies are available, solutions are available. Are you able to connect well is a key question. And because of new solutions, the landscape of the hassle map itself is dramatically changing. If you look at voice in the user interface side, suddenly it is closing the digital divide for you, right? People don't have to install software into their phone or system. If they can speak to it, they can access it. Suddenly, I would say, you know, about 50% of the population is able to get into the ecosystem. You know, it could be for commerce purpose, it could be for development. There are low code development systems that are out there. So that as a user interface, when it comes up, the hassle map for services company is suddenly taking a new shape. And, you know, should they be looking at developing services or should they go non-linear by acquiring a very good company that is established well? So those are options for corporates to expand into, if you will, right? That is one aspect of it. The next aspect of the user interface, if you look at it, is going into AR and VR. They want to give an immersive experience to the user. Now, again, the landscape is completely changing. You know, how do you train people? You know, they call it dull, dangerous, and duplicate work. How does it change the landscape? So the user interface itself is going through dramatic changes, and the hazard map, that is where, you know, it gets a new position in there that, you know, can technology be plugged in a rapid fashion to generate new solution. You know, that is what is happening. And when you come from the business angle, another trend that is hitting it is the design thinking. Design thinking directly goes into, should it be technology front end, or are you designing the system for the user requirement? If you are having some feature only for satisfying your ego or your technical capability, then take it out, is what design thinking is talking about. They are bringing in the empathy component into it. So it is completely changing in terms of introducing products, services, even the new architectures of business. If you look at it from the service, as a service perspective, how are you going to make it happen? If you look at it purely from the technology perspective, how are you going to make sure that the serverless architecture is going to help in terms of scaling up and scaling down and things like that, right? You know, that is the front end. If we come to the middle, there is this big gorilla that is sitting there, that is machine learning. You know, how do you adapt it for your need? Should it be deep learning? Should it be referential? Should it be, a neural net? There are different options that are there. It's not only on data, it is on image, it is on sound, it is on ultraviolet, infrared, every other aspect of it, you can put a artificial intelligence into it. And then RPA, you know, there are endless technologies that are available. If you want to look at the landscape, there are 2000 technologies that are available today. And the emerging side, you can have about 60 or 80 of them. You can pick and choose what is right for you. Even that could be a kind of a hazard map, you could say. And the last one is the computational and the storage aspect itself. That is also is dramatically changing. So I think it gives more value and reason for hazard map to connect to technology and then build your solution in a fashion where you don't have to necessarily handcraft it or engineer it yourself. You can also include the startup ecosystem to make it happen faster for you, if you will.
Awesome. I think that kind of summed up pretty well, but looks like we need a hassle map to solve the technology validation itself, right? That brings another interesting question, Shiv. With all these tools and technologies out there, solutions and startups, how do we actually identify what customers want and what actually they buy?
Yeah, so Kaushik, just to take to what Murli has said, right? The emergence of technology has completely changed the way a customer would want to tackle a hassle that he has. A lot of hassles were existing. There were not great technologies to, you know, solve that. Like if you look at the hospitality industry wanted to give an experience to all the people who want to book online. Before they book online, can I have a look at what kind of room that I would take, right? Especially when you go for a holiday with your family and all that. You not only want to know what is available, how the rooms are, you also want to know what are the facilities, what are the entertainment. Today with technology, what Murli is talking about, all those functionalities, all those experience, you can actually give a consumer. When they come there, they are already geared up to know exactly what they're getting. So those hassles were there. Technology has absolutely helped them eliminate that, or at least give a lot of insights to them. So that's one. I mean, COVID is going to completely revolutionize your healthcare space altogether, right? The hassles that people have had, right, from finding a hospital to oxygen bed to getting a doctor. How is with so much technology available, right, from wearables to having your oxygen meter available on your wristwatch, this whole healthcare industry itself will evolve into a new direction, because there has been hassles. technology is available to solve those hassles, and you will see a different trend coming out in the healthcare sector altogether.
But how do you identify what the customer wants versus what he actually buys? But these are all good to have, right? But will they really buy?
See, that's the journey that one needs to take, right? If you knew that right at the beginning, everyone would have created amazing products. It's a journey that you go through. Obviously, you find those dark spaces which are not supported by other products, and then you try to build something. For example, an interesting product that I saw was Coda. I mean, I don't know how many of you have utilized Coda. Now, Coda has seen the area of all the trouble that a traditional people use with having multiple Excel sheets, multiple Word sheets. How do I have all of that under one doc and then reuse my table multiple times? So that was the hassle, but it was not an implicit one, but back of the mind, you and me have already faced, right? I got 100 Word docs, I got 20 Excel table. How do I, juggle with that? So Coda seen that as the space and created that. So
I have a quick thought. I mean, when Shiva was talking about the hospitality industry, think about something like Airbnb or OYO, completely disrupted the market in terms of what is a hospitality industry. So that is interesting to think about as well, right? The second point is, how do you know what the customer wants, right? That is a tough journey. But in terms of landscape, if you look at it, when the enterprise goes for business as usual, their hassle list is different. But the innovators outside the startup ecosystem is constantly looking at developing alternative systems for you. And then you need to be looking at that, actually. And then if you integrate both, then you have new things. I think it is a journey where you need to keep your mind open in terms of small solutions you can build, and in terms of non-linearly grow, in terms of absorbing some of the startup ecosystem companies, if you will.
Question that you asked, how would you be sure that your customer is going to buy the service? But I think the fundamental thing is that each customer is different, and the hassles that each customer experiences also will be different. So just like, the same service that was provided was able to wow Shiv, at the same time, Suhas did not like it that much. So the reason is the hassle that Suhas perceives in his personal experience is very different from what Shiv perceives. So that way you need to have not just looking at the process and re-engineer or do the hassle mapping from your perspective. It is very important to bring in your customer's perspective. So that is the fundamental thing. And the other part is all your customers are not the same. So you need to have a clear distinction of what are the general categorization or segmentation of your customers, which is the segment of the customer that you are trying to sell your business to, and what are the general hassles that they are facing in consuming your service. If you do not do that, you may actually end up solving some other hassle which may not actually result in the outcome that you are looking for. So the outcome that you are going after should be very, very clear in your mind. And then the path will, hassle map might give you a good tool to get closer to the solution on that. I just wanted to add that.
Sure. And just to add to what Kesar said, you can't be everything to everybody. Very clear. So, if in an airline industry, you can't be there. If you're charged for 10 million passengers, you can't be the same to all 10 million. Who are your 80% revenue churner? Are the guys you want to create that experience? You don't mind the rest 10%, whether they are dissatisfied. I'm not bothered about that. But that 80% are my frequent traveler. And they are the guys who give me money. They're the business class traveler. They're the first class traveler. If I am able to create an experience for them and, eliminate the hassle that they have, I am not bothered about the 10% because they are not my frequent traveler.
Understood.
That's what it said. As Kesa said, experience, it is whom you want to cater, and therefore understand their pain points and ensure that.
Absolutely. So Swami, just to make sure that everybody else knows about this question, it's saying in a typical B2C startup or enterprise, we can map the customer's journey and looks to be fairly easy and straightforward because the customer itself is rather him or herself as you. Very relatable, like the flying experience, and I think we have tied it down already so many times. What's the technique to customer journey mapping and hassle mapping in an unknown setup, an example shop floor digital experience?
I believe referring to the enterprise audience, right?
Manufacturing setup, those kinds of things.
So the, again, very fundamental to this is like age-old technique of going and observing at one end. Second end, creating your own visual maps of how it would be even before going there, stepping into that zone. But then once you reach there, you observe how things are done. Clarify or, you know, map it back to your own visualizations, and then the, you know, techniques of domain expert interviewing, techniques of having, you know, conducting workshops. All of these will help you unearth more and more and more of the customer pain points, which put in the entire journey of a hassle map, you would be able to unearth it. Again, with our experience in the past, right? Every time we have not been able to do it in one go. Take an example of dairy. Dairy manufacturing, right from the step from a farm gate, milk collection starts, you know, the journey actually starts from there if you are talking about a logistics startup into the enterprise zone, right? So the milk collection from a farm gate is a very different type of people whom we interact. Then it comes to chillers, again, a very different type of people we interact. Then it comes to plant, where it is processed, a completely different set of people. Goes to the packaging, the rest of the supply chain of distribution to hubs and spokes, and then the last mile to your home, right? The entire value chain have a very different set of stakeholders, with different needs, different thinking on how a supply chain system should work, different thinking on how the technology should help them, and the challenges they face today on a day-to-day basis. So once you identify whom do you want to solve first, what do you want to solve, then like the segmentation KSR was talking about, then visualizing in your own mind how this ecosystem might work, and then getting into the plant or to the chiller unit and, you know, observing the operation, identifying the pain points which you already noted down, creating prototypes and then taking them, trying to play with that, etc. It's a journey. It cannot be, according to our experience, cannot be solved in one go. But as and when you unearth more and more and more pain points, if you are receptive to the environment, there's a lot more you will unearth and we will be able to solve the problem. Not necessarily that we have to be the consumer, but ourselves.
Murli, you're wanting to add something to it?
I thought I'll add a couple of thoughts around how a larger corporate is having some challenges. It already has its hassles because of its size and its operational compliance with government and things like that. You know, startups are looked at more favorably, or, you know, they are being looked at innovators. So they can probably get away with not necessarily complying with everything, right? You know, so I think, you know, it's a little bit easy for them in terms of pivoting around new ideas. Whereas corporate will have to think a lot. I remember consulting for Cognizant when they did similar services on the auto. They want to do an Uber kind of thing, but they are very afraid of liabilities that they have to carry out as an enterprise. But whereas, you know, a startup or a new set of small groups is able to look at that risk as something that they can carry out and do it. That is one part. Second part is, you know, larger organization is saddled with what is known as the innovator's dilemma. They have business as usual have to carry out, right? And over and beyond that, in order to put money, resources and effort to do an innovation and find out a hassle and figure out how to go about doing that, should I be doing that, or should I have a ecosystem or nurture an ecosystem to develop startups and, you know, and I will acquire them as and when needed. You know, there are a lot of corporates that have taken that approach, right? So I think, you know, I think both the corporate and startups will have to look at ways in which they can supplement each other in terms of building up this hassle map, exchanging it and building up the solutions, if you will. That was my talk on that.
Very true. And this also de-risks the enterprise from a potential failure in terms of, you know, the solution not being actually up to the standard, right?
Absolutely.
Startup can fail and can rebound. Not a
great. So that's going to be another question to you, stating with all these things happening, how is the digital transformation journey in India will evolve over the next few years?
You know, it completely depends on consultant, so I have to say use depends at least once in the conversation. Depends on which industry you're talking about. So if you're talking about, I don't know, insurance has a particular sector, it was slow to start, there's a whole bunch of stuff happening. FMCG, retail, slow. It always has been. The uptake of technology has always been slow, so it's slow. I would think that, let's say we're talking about it the other day as well, the AMC space, that perhaps is just getting ripe for these kind of situations. You know, the way this happens is, and I'm just dragging a conversation from just a while earlier, with digital transformation and HasselMap, the way I see it, it's not necessarily the pain point of a particular customer that you are looking at, right? And because DX is completely customer centric, that's supposed to be the fulcrum of it. So if I go back to a HasselMap type of a scenario, am I just looking at a human being or am I looking at an overall systemic problem? That also should go and push forth a digital transformation either in a country or an industry. I'll use two very quick examples. Let's say in drug research, drug trials, if you have a carcinogen related drug being tested, likely is happening over 5,000-6,000 different investigator sites across two, three years globally. Patients are being investigated through for the drug. They likely are getting tested every 15-20 days, which means that there is a bunch of tests which are happening on them every 15-20 days with bunches of parameters. Every set of tests likely is throwing maybe some 70-80 different data points. There's no way in hell a doctor or a physician, the investigator in this case, can collate all this in his or her head across a bunch of these test cycles. Impossible to do. But this does not impact a particular individual. So unless I introduce some sort of technology to be able to assimilate this together, this is a hassle. So this is a systemic hassle not related to any particular individual unless I solve this through thinking of a hassle map because of now this overall value chain. This is not a customer journey, but my overall value chain is getting impacted and I start using hassle maps to be able to start addressing that. Then I start using technology as an enabler or whatever else, right? Or I might reimagine. So the reimagine part, if I were to take one more example, insurance and healthcare again. So payer provider on two sides, at least in India, the amount of paperwork which flows between provider and payer and back and forth is extremely painful. And because the process does not get done, and also in case of cashless, what many of these payers are resorting to do is they just reset the clock by asking a question. They ask a question to the provider and that resets the clock for them. The 2-hour moratorium is done and it comes back. So here is a problem not between the payer provider. The problem indirectly goes and hits the patient, the third P in the cycle. So if I start thinking from his or her point of view now, then I should be creating some sort of an EDI. I could say blockchain, but some sort of a trusted mechanism of EDI which flows between these two. And I know that the documentation which is coming from the hospital is all accurate. So these are the triggers which go or should fire digital transformation. And the amount of hassle that there is. So unless that corporate or that company is actually facing that hassle, finally, in terms of that, DX doesn't move. The only other place that it moves is if there is a potential very large disruption, as we were talking about jam earlier, if there's sudden opportunity that could get enabled by using of technology or whatever else, then DX kicks in. That's a very long winded answer for what will happen for DX in the next 5 years. That's what triggers it.
Makes absolute sense. So that, you have discussed too much about the hassles per se. Just to bring the topic into connotation, hassle maps and value creation. How does this translate to value creation? And Kesar, I'll start with you. Just removing hassles itself is a value?
May not be. In some cases, it can be. Like, for example, you know, one personal example that I can quote is I was trying to order some medicines online. I've been trying to do that over the past several months. Every time I come to the stage where it asks one medicine in a bunch of 10 medicines that I'm trying to order, it requires a prescription because it is a Schedule H drug. I may not be aware of it, and I'm used to buying that over the counter, just going to a pharmacy, and in India, it is quite common, right? So then once that hit it, so I know for sure that, okay, either I have to go to a doctor or I have to go to the pharmacy to solve my problem. So then I drop all the other 10 medicines that I was about to order, right? And then go to the pharmacy and get the things that I need anyway. So now that was the hassle that I was facing. And obviously this was actually not creating enough demand for the online pharmacy companies. But now I see that many of the pharmacy companies are adopting, the moment you come to a stage where you need a prescription, they're actually providing a free consultation with a doctor, just a couple of minutes of phone call, they initiate the call and then give you the prescription for that and then proceed with the order. So by removing that small hassle from my journey, they're able to increase the demand for themselves. And this particular hassle, I tend to believe that there will be hundreds of thousands of people like me who come up to that point and hit the roadblock and then say, hey, I'm giving up. I'm not going to use this service anymore. So that, in terms of hassle map, solving the problem itself can create enormous demand. And if that is actually the critical problem that is happening. On the other hand, you come to a point where you find the hassle, there may not be an easy solution to just remove that hassle. So you may actually end up redesigning your service around it. So thereby you are doing something, you know, what Suhas termed as reimagining your service. And thereby actually you create a lot more value that you can deliver through your service. So your service itself will become that much more valuable. So similar to what Netflix was able to do in terms of, you know, moving away from the rental cassettes to mail in DVDs. And they also kept their eyes and ears open where the technology, when it was available, they were the first guys who actually created online streaming, just taking the example. And so if they were not able to do that, they stuck into that mail-in DVD orders, then maybe some other company would have come in and then taken that space. But they did not do that. They constantly kept looking at the technology that is available out there. And they also were looking for the hassles within the new business model that they created. So that's where they were able to do that leap of development and continue to dominate this market.
Yes, Murli. I mean, catching up on the Netflix example, you know, the result of that is most of the entertainment industry is saying we are not going to produce any DVD in the future at all, right? You know, that OTT as a technology has completely destroyed the DVD industry, I would say. Go ahead, Suhas.
Sure. I would stress on one particular thing that KSR mentioned, and I see this in practical life, or at least in our lives. Trinane is a strategy consulting transformation company, of course. And as we look at into today's world, these DX type of scenarios, you know, we start with looking at a problem and hence a hassle map or an empathy map. And perhaps there's a little bit of a misnomer otherwise. The hassle map by itself takes me only so far and does nothing more. So unless I use the hassle map as my very strong trigger point and then start looking at how do I now solve that problem. So for KSR's example, if I were to just look at that hassle, oh, let me try and provide a mechanism to just get a prescription, ask KSR to take a picture of an old prescription or something, that I don't think is a solution. The fact that a doctor calls you, assesses his situation and provides that solution or that prescription, that becomes a solution, which means that the value gets added, not just because, at least in my mind, not because of the hassle map, but because of the fact that you look at that hassle empathetically, perhaps rank out what the problem areas are and then start looking at now what do I do? Do I reimagine? Do I use design thinking or whatever other particular type of solution, which might come either through technology or otherwise? Without that chain does not get completed. Absolutely. So hassle map in my mind is a lovely trigger, but that doesn't provide you that solution.
Right. And so I see this more as, you know, actually adding value. But the question is it adding value only to an existing process or an existing problem? Does it curtail innovation?
No, I don't think it curtails innovation. See, actually, Adrian, who actually introduced the concept of hassle map, he said, if you're able to apply the hassle map thinking when you are designing your service, you might actually end up creating this revolutionary product or service even before your customers know that they want it. So we are actually talking about, you know, creating a new service which can be potentially revolutionary.
You know, when you say hassle map, it's very specific to your context. If you are thinking of a context-free, completely new product imagination, there could be some challenges there. I'm thinking aloud, but again, you know, even if you make a completely imaginative product, somebody will have to use it. Maybe, you know, you may have to eventually have a hazard map is what I feel. I'm thinking, you know, something like a space related startups are picking up. So what kind of hazard map will they have? I have no idea. It may be interesting to have a session on that.
Absolutely. First and foremost, apologies. Shubh had to step out. He had a hard stop at 6:30 India time. So that's why he left. You saw the thumbs up in between. That was without creating any hassles for you to say that he's exiting. So any closing remarks from each one of you? And we can probably this time go clockwise. Start with you, Suhas.
Sure. Two closing thoughts, Kaushik. One, of course, is, as I mentioned, use the hassle map or an empathy map as your starting point to redo a journey or to create a fresh journey. While I say this, which also obviously means that it is not necessary that a journey that you recreate or create all new is necessarily customer specific for sure, but it does not necessarily generate from a customer. It could be a systemic problem that you're trying to fix. It might not directly impact a customer right there, but the overall outcome might. Which also means that as we talk about a hassle map or a customer journey or DX, it is very important, at least in my mind, to keep in mind what. So essentially I was saying, look at what your outcome is or what outcome do you really want and go back from there. The solution might lay in a systemic thing. It might be customer focused. You might be looking at empathy. You might be looking at how to reimagine, use whatever tools. But it's not as straightforward or it's not a boxed type of a thinking that is required.
Absolutely.
Probably it has been said already, but I'm thinking that though it's not a boxed solution that we are looking at it, maybe as a group, you know, we kind of collect together and build a catalog of hazards and solutions. Our technology solutions can solve these kind of problem, this kind of productivity and efficiency that you could have. That can be a quick reference for people to figure out who are the people who can help you in those kind of hazards, if you will, you know. So that will be a useful catalog to build.
Absolutely. And I think like every other entrepreneur and every other, you know, corporate, I'll say, you will lead it, we will follow, we'll assign the task to you.
I just wanted to leave with a thought saying, you know, when you talk about hazard map and also the value created by arriving at a solution using hazard map, it is very time bound. It is a continuous process. It has to be relooked again and again. For example, what a big basket did for an apartment complex of group buying during the pandemic is not necessarily a relevant thing post pandemic. What a traditional automobile service station is doing for pandemic of no touch, just drop and go kind of a model might not fly after the pandemic. So a lot of these which are hazards today need not necessarily be a hazard tomorrow, like an on-call to a radio to a mobile-based taxi booking. These are very contextual, time-bound hazards, and based on technology improvements, the hazard can take a different dimension and the solutions can also be like completely revisited. So it has to be a continuous process, and every organization, be it a startup or an enterprise, should look at it as a re-evaluating thing on an ongoing basis.
Perfect. Okay, sir.
That was going to be my exact point, where you need to do this exercise on an ongoing basis because the context keeps. So one thing I wanted to say is that value created is not is a permanent thing. Value, when it is created, usually it may get lost if you do not communicate it properly also. So many times a great value is created, you know, most of the times in the case of enterprises, and also in some cases in the startup companies as well, the communication actually becomes the factor where you lose the value that is created if it is not communicated. And, you know, that may cause less adoption. You may be thinking that you have created a huge value, but if it is not perceived as such by the customers, you may actually not get the traction that you're looking for and the outcome that you're looking for. So communication is something that you should not keep your eyes off of, even though you are doing all the other things.
Right. And I think so communication becomes the key, like in any other situation. So guys, thank you so much. Before I say thanks to the speakers and the panelists, thank you attendees. Thank you for taking time. I just want to also thank our co-sponsors, Axon Network, MV Technologies, Madras Mindworks, and Adway. Adway has also been our marketing partner, supporting us with all these sessions. So KSR, Murli, Swami and Suhas, thank you. Thanks to Shiv, even though it's not there. Thank you so much and namaste.